going to be learning Likkutei Sichot, Volume 4.
Where did you get this from?
Wow.
Amazing.
Volume 4, Parshas Matos.
That's your copy?
It's my copy. You want the big one? You need bigger?
No, I want the whole set.
Okay, so get the whole set.
Come back for me.
Inyan HaNedarim. How do you say Nedarim in English? The vows.
Vows, yeah.
The issue of vows in Parshas Matos, the Mishnah Nedarim Se'ag Deprishut. As the Mishnah says, Nedarim, vows are used.
Fence against immorality.
That's a very specific interpretation. Prishut just means refraining from being too connected to the world. It's just to be parush is not to be overly indulgent, not to be overly connected to material.
Well, the world is either immorality or eating too much.
That's most of the things, but it could be other things like sleeping. Yeah, people will sleep too much.
Oh, yeah?
Especially when they're young. You don't remember this, but when you were young, you could sleep for 16 hours.
I don't ever remember doing that.
Yeah, maybe you didn't, because you had a vow that you wouldn't sleep that much. There's people who need women, for instance. Shopping. I vow that I will never spend more than $15,000 when I go out to shop, right? Things like that.
Right.
It could be anything. But it's the person feels that he's too connected, he's too involved in physical matters, he wants to disconnect from it. By the way, it could also be drinking. Okay? A vow could be something that that helps a person get over an addiction.
Okay, what about the fact that you're not supposed to refrain? From those things, which
right. So that's what he's going to talk about.
Oh, okay.
So the Rebbe says, it means that the person is refraining from things that in and of themselves are permissible.
Right.
And it is considered, making a vow is considered part of the avoda, part of the service called Kadesh HaTmcha B'Mutar Lecha. You should sanctify yourself
in that which is permissible.
In that which is permissible. Even though in the Yerushalmi it says, here's what you just said, that it's enough for you to hold by the prohibitions that the Torah subscribed. There's enough prohibitions in the Torah, you don't need more than that.
Gimik.
Okay? He's a big, tremendous chap here. That limiting yourself only to that which the Torah prohibited is all well and good for someone who is straight. Straight in the definition of the Torah, that God made man straight. Meaning that he's
keeping all the Torah mitzvahs.
He's normal.
Well,
normal according to the Torah. That he's a man the way that a man should be. In that case, he doesn't have to refrain from those permissible things. And in that case, like everyone knows, you shouldn't. You're not allowed to make a vow.
Is there any other problem? If he's a straight person, he's living exactly as the Torah says, right? Then what does he need to make vows for?
That's exactly it. So he's not allowed to. Aye, there's two types of vows.
Where's the Nazir coming?
There's two types of vows. Hold on. So the Nazir, there's a lot of questions about whether the Nazir is a good guy or a bad guy. So the sages right away say that it's not stamped that the Nazir decided to be a Nazir. He decided to be a Nazir because he saw himself being attracted to things that he shouldn't be. He saw his connection to things. In any case, but getting back, there's two different things. And that's why I didn't like the word vow, because of that we can use another synonym called oath. There's a shvuah and a neder. Okay. There's all kinds of shvuot also. What's the difference between a shvuah and a neder? A neder is saying, I will not use these pieces of paper. So the neder has an object, has to have an object. I have to say specifically and explicitly which objects, which things in the world am I now making prohibited for myself. will I now refrain from touching, using, etc. That's a neder. That's what we translated as a vow. There's another word called shvu'ah, oath, which has to do with the person, not with the object. The person says about himself, I will not do so-and-so, or I will do so-and-so. You can't do a neder that's positive.
It's more abstract.
No, it's more subjective. It has to do with the subject. It has to do with the person. The neder has to do with the object. Meaning, I'm making something prohibited for me. When I say this, I'm noder from this, I'm taking an oath from this, a vow from this, it's always from, then it means that this is prohibited for me. I myself have not undergone any changes. But when it comes to a shvua means that I am now obligated or prevented from doing something. So if I say, I make a vow to not use this, and so this did not change at all for me. This is still the same object. I am prohibited from using it. Okay? There's all kinds of explanations about the differences. But one of the main differences is that you cannot make a neder that is positive. It has to be negative, by definition. Because you're always prohibiting something from yourself. So you're looking at an object and you're saying, this is prohibited. When you talk about a vow, about an oath, what I'm calling a shvuah, a shvuah can also be positive. What's the most important shvuah? The most important shvuah that a person has is nishava ala mitzvot. That he makes an oath to do a mitzvah. Why is that so important? Because it's a mitzvah. It's a mitzvah sa'aseh. It's a positive mitzvah, because everything else is negative. You're saying the neder I make is always negative. Here I have a chance to do something that's positive. So I say to myself, I make an oath from now on to come here, let's say, at 7 o'clock. Okay? I now have that mitzvah on me. This is for me like a mitzvah from the Torah now. If I don't do it, I'm chayav. I have to bring a korban. But the korban is not the korban, it's a chatat, but it's a asham for the shvua that I didn't do. Okay, but that's very important, that there's a different category which people usually translate differently, so you can call it an oath. But again, the words are neder and shvua. Okay? In any case, so the neder, עליו החובה לעשות בדברים שהם פחותים ממנו, דומה מצומח החי שלמטה מדבר כדי להרתם. When a person is kosher and yusha, he's acting exactly the way the Torah wants, not more, not less, then he has an obligation to eat. He has an obligation to deal with all those things that are lesser than him. We are speakers, human beings are speakers, and we have a responsibility towards the animals, the vegetables, and the minerals to elevate them by consuming them, by using them in different ways, by making use of them. And if we don't do that, then it's an avera, actually. אבל כאשר מתנהגים באופן שבהמה ביקשו חשבונות רבים, so the opposite of עשה אלוקים את האדם ישר is a continuation of that verse. והמה ביקשו חשבונות רבים. God made man straight, but they searched for many machinations. And so when a person is...
Machinations.
That's in Wales. In the US of A, which invented English, as you know, we say machinations. So anyway, I hope so. You know, somebody who's listening will probably write, Yaakov had it right, so it'd be machinations. But I've heard it said by people, by professors. So everybody I've heard ever said machinations. But anyway, so the person has ulterior motives, he has all kinds of chishbonos, then this doesn't hold. חיפוש אחר כל החשבונות וההצטדקויות כיצד להיות שקוע בעולם אינו מרכבה לאלוקות. So he has all these חשבון, all these deviant thoughts about how he's going to utilize the world better. He's thinking about the cruise he's going to take, and he's thinking about the flight he's going to the vacation he's going to go, and this and that. He's thinking about the food he's going to buy, not for Shabbos, for a regular weekday, and how it's going to be delicious, and so on. So all these cheshbonos, all these excuses about how to be immersed further in the physical world makes him stop being a chariot for godliness. ויש לו תענוג בדברים הגשמיים, and he receives a lot of pleasure, or just pleasure, he receives pleasure from physical objects. Now, it sounds very strange. What does it mean? What do you mean by receiving pleasure from physical things? So, first of all, you can think that 150 years ago, let's say, it was very uncommon to have very many sweet things. Things were not sweet that much. First of all, sugar was much more expensive. But even if they sweetened, what are they sweetened? They sweetened their pudding. They make cakes. But to have that sugar is added to everything, that was like unheard of. Certainly if you go back 500 years, go back 1,000 years, it's very uncommon. But today, it's a staple. What does it mean that it's a staple? It's in everything. So when do people suddenly realize that there's a world without sugar? It's when they start getting diabetes. Then they understand that there's a world out there that doesn't use the sugar. There's enough sugar in everything. Maybe fruits and vegetables, tons of sugar. In fact, diabetics can't eat too many fruits. Maybe eat one fruit a day. And sometimes not even that. Diabetics. So what was considered to be a person who was pavush 200 years ago? Someone who never ate sugar. Today, somebody who doesn't eat sugar, it's not just a pavush, you should bow down to him. It's like, what do you mean, he doesn't eat sugar? That's the thing. Again, I'm saying somebody who the doctors don't tell them that you can't eat sugar. Someone who decided, I'm not going to eat sugar. It's almost unheard of. All the more so, somebody who's not going to eat all the other junk that is on the shelves. The movement from eating processed foods to eating only what you prepare at home, for most people this is like they can't even think about it. I've seen people that because of dietary reasons have had to stop eating processed food, and now they have to, and they're very limited in their diet, and they're mamish broken for years. Some of them never recover, some of them can't follow the diet because they simply can't. So we're so ingrained, so immersed in this indulgence culture.
Is that why my bread is full of grains?
What?
Is that why my bread is full of grains?
Yeah. I have to say those louder so everybody can enjoy, not just me. In any case, הרי אז לא רק שלא יעלה את הדבר בשמי על ידי שישתמש בו, אלא אדרבה, התאווה בתענוג שיש לו בדבר מאכל וכדומה תוריד אותו, ותפעול גם ירידה במאכל. לכן חייבת להיות אצלו סדר של נדרים ופרישות. He says, these people, most of us, who are not a chariot for godliness, not only will we not be able to elevate what we're eating, because eating potato chips, you're not elevating them, you're actually going further down. Not only are you not elevating the potato chips, you yourself are becoming more and more immersed and drowning in physical indulgence.
So what about a guy who says, I promise that if Hashem gives me this year $1 million, I'm going to give 20%.
That's a shavua.
That's a shavua?
Yeah.
Why? Because it goes on the money?
What?
Where's the abstract? The non-abstract.
No, it's a positive thing. He has to do something. A nidr can't be positive. You don't call them a nidr. A nidr, tachlis, is prishut. It has to be that I refrain from something. Otherwise, it's a shavua. That's why they're very close, because a lot of times people call Shavuot Nedarim. In Muslim literature, they're almost interchangeable. There is a difference. So a person has to have, people like us have to have Nedarim. We have to use these vows, these ways to refrain, to detach ourselves from overindulgence. But the middle is it. This little guy, he's winning against you. ודומה לזה הוא גם טעם הגדרים והסייגים שונים שתקנו חז"ל, בעיקר בזמן בית שני. Very similar to this are all the, what did you call them? גדרים and סייגים, you call the סייגים the fences that the sages put around the Torah in the Second Temple period. Why is it similar? What's the similarity? So the similarity, he says, is that during the First Temple period, he ir elokut begilu. You did it?
Yeah, broke the phone. That's it.
Yeah, you're going to break your phone. He's going to win a lot. You're going to break your feet, break your phone, and he's going to fly off and die tomorrow.
Yeah, he's dead.
What? He's dead? Okay. So we have a...
Kaddish.
Yeah, Celtic. Anyway, Mizman Bayit Rishon Yer Elokut Begilui. During the first temple period, godliness was apparent. What does it mean that it was apparent?
Yes. See the Shekhinah.
People felt it. What do you mean felt it? In the same way that you can imagine that the sun wouldn't shine so strongly, and you wouldn't feel the warmth of the sun on your face. So there you would say, the sun changed. It's not shining as brightly. Okay? In the same way, there was something that was shining much more brightly, and there were people became sensitive to it. Ah, but that's not so good, not such a good explanation. Why is it not a good explanation? Because Shekhinah is always the same. Yeah, you're right, it goes into Galus, it does this, it does that. But still, we have an understanding that the problem is not only that the Shekhinah changed. The problem is that we changed.
Shekhinah stayed the same.
Shekhinah, in a certain sense, stayed the same. We're not able to receive it. But still, it says about the Shekhinah, there's also objective changes. Why? Because we said it went into Galus. It's not the same way that it was.
It went back. It retreated.
Okay, it retreated. So we said it did retreat at some level. So it is that the sun became like the sun becoming a little bit less warm. Okay? Now, look at what the scientists say about 1 degree change in the warmth of the sun. 2 degrees change. 3 degrees. You're talking about up to, I don't know, if the sun is the average temperature, let's say, about 300 Kelvin. Yeah? That's the average temperature. So 1 degree change, which is how much? 0.03. Well, 0.3%. 1 degree change of 300 is 0.3%. A percent change, they think the world is going to become water world. That everything is going to melt. All the ice caps are going to, everything, we're going to drown. There's going to be no dry land. They say about this at 1%. Now imagine about the Shekhinah. The Shekhinah went up 7 levels. I don't know if it's up 7 levels now, but it retreated. I don't know if it retreated. One level, 2 levels, 3 levels, I don't know how many. But it retreated. So some percentage changed. So imagine if the physical world would change so much by just 1% of the sun's heat, either way. Right? They say that an ice age is exactly the opposite, it goes down by 1%, 2%. So why am I using Kelvin? Because if you say 30 degrees Celsius, it doesn't mean anything. If you say 80 degrees Fahrenheit, it doesn't mean anything, because the change is from zero, absolute zero. That's the real change, so you have to measure it in Kelvins. So you get this 1% change that's going to change the entire world. Imagine what happens spiritually. That just this little change that the Shekhinah had, it already changed the world entirely. But more than that, it's not just that the Shekhinah changed, we also changed. We became less sensitive to these things, as the Rebbe. גם ב-70 שנה של אחר החורבן הראשון עדיין נותר במידה מסוימת רושם גילוי אלוקות שהיה בבית ראשון. So even during the 70 years of the exile in Babylon, there was still a residue of the full expression of the Shekhinah, the full expression of God's presence in the world, to a certain degree. אבל בבית שני שהיה חסר בגילוי אור הקדושה, but the second temple, where there was, and the Rebbe here says, בגילוי אור השכינה, that the revelation of the divine light would change, and it was revealed no longer as it was before. משום כך גבר החושך הלעומת זה. And because of that, because of this change in the revelation of godliness, the other side became stronger. It's very interesting. Why, how can you say this? Well, you're saying there's no idolatry before. If anything, the world advanced. No, the world advanced because godliness was no longer an issue. The world moved forward because you could say anything. You could say anything. You could say God is a flying spaghetti monster. You say anything you want. Why? Because nobody knows. Nobody feels anything. Nobody knows. You say something to someone and say, no, okay. I'll believe in this, I'll believe in that, what do I care? I'll believe that this guy came up from the dead, I'll believe that this guy was God. whatever you want. I'll believe this Michigander from Saudi Arabia talked to an angel and he brought down a book. Whatever you want. I'll believe that some guy in Utah found a book in a cave. And that's the new Bible. Anything you want. Why? Because nobody has a sense. Nobody knows what, nobody knows if it's right or not. Because godliness is hidden. If I would come to people and say, oh, it's a beautiful day outside, and it's, you know, it's a minus 20 degrees, you're nuts. But if nobody could feel hot or cold, so I could say anything I wanted. It's a beautiful day, it's a cold day, it's a hot day, nobody would know. Nobody would have any clue. That's exactly what happened. So there was more idolatry before, but the idolatry was a misconception of what they felt, meaning that they felt the heat, and they said, oh, you know what the right thing to do when the heat is to go out to the beach half naked. That's what you're doing when it's hot. And other people said, no, you know why it's hot now? It's hot now because Hashem wants us to use the opportunity to plow our fields, prepare them for the winter, for the fall, to prepare them for the rains. That's what he wants from us. So everybody understood what was going on. It was godliness revealed, but they didn't understand what you needed to do with it. So the people had a void of Zara. They meant to serve the godliness that they felt. But the godliness that they felt, they served in the wrong way. So that's called the void of Zara. Today, it's very hard to believe that the stuff is even a void of Zara. That's what we say. It's Maaseh Avodeihem Yidden. We say they're just following the traditions of their fathers. There's a Christian who really thinks that it's this way or that way. The whole, all of Christianity was built after people didn't have a sense of godliness anymore. So you could say anything you wanted, any nonsense you wanted. It didn't matter. Did they not say nonsense before? They also said nonsense before, but they worshipped. They worshipped for real. They were willing to kill people for it. Meaning they felt so strongly that this was something that they needed to worship, that they were willing to kill people. Christianity already is not willing to kill people.
Who is that?
Christianity. They stopped killing people.
They did?
They don't offer them as sacrifices. No, they kill people for other reasons. So these changes, what a change this made. So I think we have to end up, right? So it says the Rebbe, the moment that you have all this darkness descending into the world, there's no sense of godliness. You need to have these fences around the Torah. You have to have them. They must be there. So for us to say that the Dharam are just precious, they're just a fence, you don't need fences. You should only do... You should make do with what the Torah prohibited, says the Rebbe. That's not true. Because in our times, there's enough darkness that you need to do that extra thing, and have this extra barrier in order just to keep yourself along the proper route. And we'll meet again on Sunday, God willing.
Right, now you're going to go.